it actually went together. You skate all day, and then everybody met at the skate park, and you went to the show at night, and you pogoed, and then you partied, and then you woke up at noon, and you skated, and then you found a show the next night, and then you put a band together. Skateboarding's great. It'll always be great to me. I don't care about the sport of it. I never called it a sport. I got into skateboarding because it wasn't a sport, and you do it on your own. I'm a punk rocker and a skateboarder, period.
Odds are dead, odds are dead. I don't even care, you're the one that cares. You can ride in the bed, we're riding in the bed. My bitch, who I call in 1991. Odds are dead, odds are dead. You can't convince me cause you're too far gone. Odds are dead, odds are dead. I'm already hard, it's a matter of time. 1991 and I'm running out of time. If you can't see the answer, then I'll help you when I'm dead. God tells me that I'm wrong. Dead has to be far gone, man. Dead, fun, slow death. Mark how well you can have my chance. Put you in my world, we'll be there when I'm gone. Picture what I call a 1991. Hearts of death, hearts of death. I bet you I call him 1991. I saw death, I saw death. I bet you I call him 1991. I saw death, I saw death.
A punk rocker and a skateboarder. That's what it boils down to. But over the years, Dwayne has lived it all. He's a legend, a nobody, a champion, a loser, an inspiration, a junkie, a father, a deadbeat, and a dead man. That's right, Dwayne Peters should be dead. Twice, in fact. Hauled to the hospital, dead on arrival. Dead from drugs. But he came back. He pulled it. He's lived to tell about it, and his story, the good and the bad of it, spans nearly 4 decades of music and skateboarding.
Nice. Dwayne who? No.
And his nickname says it all, the Master Disaster. He's the most punk rock skateboarder out there on the planet, there's no doubt.
He was out of hand. He just didn't know what was going to happen.
He'd like go in, drop in, lock up, and just make it.
He could take so much pain more than any other person I've ever known. I mean, the fucking guy should be dead.
Death and destruction everywhere.
He has to skate and he has to play music. That's all there is to it.
He's fucking Gigi Allen and Sid Vicious, but he can skateboard, you know?
Dwayne's fucking full on, man. He's gnarly.
When you think of punk skating, it's Dwayne Peters.
He's one of the most influential skaters to ever step on a skateboard.
He's paid his dues.
9 times out of 10, if there was something outstanding to remember, Dwayne had something to do with it.
He's taken his own course, done what he wanted to do.
Dwayne is every bit as much on his game as he ever has been.
He is fucking passionate about what he is into.
The attitude's still there, and you know, that's the one thing that's cool in my book about Dwayne is he's still true blue, 100% punk rocker, and he's not going to live any other way.
Dwayne's fucked.
We like that.
There's nobody else like Dwayne. Never has been, there never will be, because he's one of a kind, and that's what separates him from the rest. And that's a fucking great quality to have, I think.
Dwayne Thomas Peters was born on June 12, 1961, in Anaheim, California, across the street from Disneyland. His folks raised the family in a typical suburban home. Dad sold cars, mom took care of the house and kids. When Dwayne was 9, divorce ripped the family apart. Dad moved out. Dwayne and his brother and sisters stayed with mom. Together, they towed the poverty line. Already a rowdy kid, Dwayne slipped further into fury. A broken home boy hotwired for risk and danger. Just ask his mom.
I bet you didn't think Dwayne had a mother. Huh? From the first pain, hour and a half, he was born. And he was ready. The doctor broke my water and cut him in the head with his knife. From that time on, no stopping him. When he started to walk and started to crawl, that was when the fun began. He was always very, very stubborn. If he set his mind to something, I don't care what you did, you couldn't change it. He just wouldn't give up. He was never one to stop, no matter what it was. He was hell-bent to do it. He'd get a hold of an old mattress out of a trash bin, and he'd jump out in front of cars in the alley just to see how close they could come before they hit him. That was just in him. And then they used to go out and play on the train tracks and see how far they could wait till the train got there to leap off. And when he started the skateboarding and stuff, it was like there was nothing that was too dangerous or too radical, or he always had to have that little edge to be the first or to be the number one to do something, almost like he had a dare with God.
In the early 70s, the grip and glide of the urethane wheel carried skaters away from the rough riding clay wheel days of the previous decade, and skateboarding ascended towards its second spike in popularity. Many of this new generation of skateboarders ignored the gymnastic trick book left over from the 60s and instead hit the streets with style and speed born from shortboard surfing. Skateboarding found Dwayne living in Orange County's Newport Beach.
First started skating when I was a kid, got a board and started skating every day, tic-tacs, slides, just basically surf skating. I was around 13, I found an empty pool. There was water in the pool, we had plywood over the water. The goal was to make it over the light, and half the guys were barefooted, half the guys had shoes on.
I knew Dwayne when he had long hair past his shoulder blades.
When I first met him, he was just learning how to skate still, and picked it up like nobody else I've ever seen.
It went from the metal wheels to the clay wheels to the early urethane ball bearing wheels to the precision urethane wheel. It went from that whole kind of surf thing to all of a sudden these kids took it and made it their own thing. And all of a sudden you had the skateboarders.
Skaters were aggressive. Skateboarding is against the law, and it fucking probably always should be, really.
We had to go underground. We had to break laws. We had to do what we had to do what we wanted to do.
Well, Dwayne was like the epitome of a blonde-haired surfer dude, 14, 15, with long hair, surfer shorts. He was a good skateboarder.
I hooked up with a crew of guys, the Tile Stick Boys.
Chris Sparks' dad was making the Mojo skateboards, but we always wanted our own.
Didn't get Pops to listen, so started making our own boards and started Tile Sticks.
Well, Tile Sticks was tie sticks, and then the L just fit in the middle for the tile.
We were just doing our own thing and having fun.
Dwayne picked up skateboarding quickly and took it into the mid-70s as its popularity surged. As skate parks cropped up across the nation and skate equipment advanced with new designs and materials, skateboarders took the ride to realms unimagined a decade earlier.
I think that he came up later because he was involved with skateboard mania.
But the massive popularity also conjured a lot of lame gimmick and spectacle. Skateboard mania was but one of those sideshows, like a flash and glam skateboarding bastard baby of professional wrestling and the ice capades. Skateboard mania drew paying crowds to watch the Earthlings battle the Cy-Phions.
Skateboard queen, skateboard queen, prettiest thing you've ever seen.
Skateboard mania was a concept in these Hollywood producers' minds as to how they can really, like, take skateboarding into the big arena.
Pretty high budget Star Wars stage show, I guess you call it.
It was kind of like a Space Odyssey skateboard show.
An intergalactic battle between the Cy-Phions and the Earthlings.
The Ice Capade Chalet or of skateboarding or something like that.
Traveling around, skating on ice.
The Cy-Phions are kind of these bad creatures from another planet. They have green hair, and Dwayne Peters was the main Cy-Phion.
Dwayne Peters is a Cy-Phion. He'll always be a Cy-Phion.
And he was just doing some incredible things, and the main thing that he did, which was really, I think, a milestone in skateboarding, was the 360 loop of death.
The death loop. A 14-foot tall steel and plexiglass pipe fed by a pair of steeply banked ramps. Show promoters hoped to wow the crowd with a 360-degree upside-down ride. Nobody had done anything like that before. Enter Dwayne, the 16-year-old unknown.
The whole ramp was plexiglass, it was clear. I don't know, I don't see how you can figure out where you are.
Dwayne charged it right off the bat and just did the loop.
I was working for Rad Ramp, helping put together ramps, and we built this thing. Dwayne was the only one I ever saw make it without the bag. After that, he broke his collarbone.
Quite a few times, he rode all the way around and came out of the end of it and would either go up the ramp and eat it or go off into the parking lot and eat it because there was just nowhere to go.
You know, I don't know what Dwayne went through with that, but I can only imagine it was very similar, that they were going doing a loop and then just hitting the wall again. Without him, I would have never had the incentive to really try it or make it a reality.
The legend of Dwayne's battles with the death loop holds that he was the first and only to ride all the way around without a crash pad. These historic upside-down runs, however, would never find their way to film. Dwayne took a dive from the pipe ceiling, snapping his collarbone before cameramen could capture the make. And his trip to the hospital prompted skateboard mania promoters to ban Dwayne from ever riding the loop again.
No, but come on, how rad is that, the guy breaking his collarbone in the loop? That's pretty fucked up. I think skateboard mania was a waste of fucking time for all of them.
Locked down on contract with skateboard mania, Dwayne missed many of the professional bull rider contests of the day. Fortunately, his reputation with the loop pushed him into the spotlight, where he immediately set out to innovate himself from his pigeonhole as the El Rolo guy. With a background built from vertical concrete and a reputation as a gutsy groundbreaker, Dwayne set out to prove that he was a formidable all-around rider and a top contender in any competition or session. Bull riding became his specialty, both in backyards and in the skate parks, but a drunken accident put him in the hospital. Liquored up on stolen booze, DP took a header down some stairs at a New Year's Eve party in 1978. The fall shattered his left elbow. Doctors were barely able to save his arm. Dwayne spent 3 months hospitalized, dreaming of skateboarding the whole time.
Well, he almost died, and at one point they were thinking about taking his arm off. I think that started him on his drug trip. He was on morphine for months.
Meanwhile, outside at the skate parks, the current crop of pros fought against each other in what would become some of the most competitive and memorable contests in skateboard history. Released from the hospital and finally back on his board, Dwayne had some catching up to do. He came back hungry and placed a respectable 10th at Oasis in his first pro contest and a 6th place finish at Boulder. Later, an upset victory at Whittier secured his place in the skate elite. He won that one with a broken toe. With the first place prize earnings, Dwayne paid drunk driving fees.
He was just being hot, but he was inventing tricks and he was pushing the envelope and he was thinking differently about skateboarding. It just opened the door to how many things were possible. And he definitely had a lot of slide maneuvers that no one can even do now. Like,
people just don't do those tricks. It was a whole new way of skating.
It was a pretty fucked up, but pretty cool, crazy fucking decade. You know, disco and punk rock were like coinciding, and styles were changing, and attitudes were changing. And, you know, the decadence of greed and money and everything was in full effect. It was, you know, life at its largest.
In 1980, if you skateboarded, you were hated. Dwayne took on the idea and the feeling of that time. It was rebellious, it was aggressive, and it was on edge, you know? It's not the way it is now. Now it's Little League.
Unlike the way skateboarders are perceived today, the skaters of the 80s were never taken seriously for their courage. They got no love and no sympathy for the frustration from being banned in the streets and on the sidewalks where their boards were born.
You know, you against the world, you against your parents, you against every 7-Eleven clerk. I mean, if you had your skateboard, you were marked.
You know, there weren't as many contests, there was no money to be made in it, not that anyone did it for that, but it was just like the whole thing kind of petered out a little bit.
During the early 80s, Dwayne was at his competitive best as the widespread popularity of skateboarding descended into a downhill slide. These were the days when Dwayne did what the skateboard world remembers him for. He made the park era come to life. With a Nazi-like appearance and a fuck you attitude, he grabbed skateboarding by the balls and gave it back to the skaters.
The whole attitude of Thrasher came out of Dwayne and Olsen's persona and the whole punk rock underground movement.
The fact that Dwayne was around and practically a mascot for Thrasher magazine, I mean, just the epitome of the attitude and where it was coming from.
The name Thrasher, I think, came out of Dwayne's mouth.
I'd call it Thrasher.
The act of thrashing, skateboarding, it's gnarly, it's raw. Thrasher.
You know, he had attitude when he skated, aggression, punk rock, and you know, all that. He's a great skateboarder, and probably more importantly, he fucking won contests.
Skating to me, it's just so hard to judge, you know. He has a very competitive style, you know. His style kind of came from all of those bowl contests.
At that point in skateboarding, style pretty much dominated everything. The tricks were almost pretty standard, and what he did was push them right to the edge.
Those contests were pretty intense. You know, those guys would come out, they'd be bloody. Crowds were small, but just yelling and screaming and shitting their pants right along with the skaters. It was parks, and it was cement, and it was pools, and kinks, and coping, and upland death sessions where I think everybody would slam. And in the heat of the battle in the Gold Cup series, against Eddie Alguera and Grisham and guys that were kind of going out, that were some of the greatest skateboarders that have ever lived.
Dwayne Peters, second on the Pro Series in skateboarding right now on the vertical or the bowl competitions. You're going to be up against Eddie Alguera, the number one man, pretty soon, probably in the finals today at the High Roller Park. How do you feel about coming up against Eddie once again?
I'm not scared or anything. He doesn't bother me. I just got to make all my tricks. And because like he's got all his own tricks and I got mine. And if I pull him off as high as I can, you know, it's all just a matter of who gets the gnarliest and who goes for it more, I guess. You know, I'm just going to try and compete and do my best.
Dwayne kept it simple. Bare bones, all style, all attitude. He had a reputation for doing his own thing, inventing most of the tricks that he performed.
Dwayne came out with the fakie thruster, the sweeper, the indie air, the invert revert, the acid drop.
His unplanned physicality was unmistakable. This style saturated his attitude and his showmanship.
Without further hesitation, we'll bring in the master of disaster from Santa Cruz, Dwayne Peters.
Kill, kill, kill.
after the first day, Dwayne would be 1, 2, or 3, pretty much guaranteed. And this was against a pretty hot group of skateboarders.
They really had to be on their game. If you wanted to compete, you had to have something new. You had to have something that nobody else was doing.
Invert reverts and stuff like that. That trick was invented on accident because he'd just hang on to anything.
You saw a lot of new blood coming in and the team rivalries. And you know, you had the Sims team with Bowman, Andrick, and Lamar, and you had the Powell Peralta team with Mike McGill and Ray Bones Rodriguez. And then you had the Verabots with Eric Grissom and Eddie Alguera. And then all of a sudden you had the Santa Cruz team, man. It was just punk as shit with Salba and Olsen and Dwayne. They were the guys that kind of brought the old school into the new school, but yet they still performed and did what needed to be done to win.
You know, that's what makes, I think, competition interesting, is that when somebody just has a totally different approach to things.
Yeah, the Big Oak Gold Cup, man, that was Dwayne's day. You know, nobody could have beat him on that day. He stayed on, he rode faster than anybody, he used his original tricks with more style than anybody. And it was perfect with his music to what he was doing, it just blew everybody away.
It was all about crowd appeal. Dwayne had the whole place standing up and just holding their heads going, oh my God.
The Gold Cup Series was sort of the series right then. You know, it was pro and am. It was all the best guys. It was at all the main parks. It had the biggest coverage. I mean, when you look back at what the coverage was, it's nothing compared to what coverage is today. But to us, it was like there were banners, and you know, it was in the magazine, so that was a huge event.
Back in the day, competitions was everything. I mean, it made you who you were, really.
It was all about your contest places. You know, it was all about how you fared against everyone else and how you were judged. And nowadays people get like a year, maybe 2 years to film parts for a video, to collect footage. We had 45 seconds to bust out. That's all we had. If you fell in that 45 seconds, you're out. You're not gonna make the finals.
And then Dwayne came on just like this unknown storm.
He never planned to run, didn't figure things out, you know.
That's why I like Dwayne, because he just throws all the rules out the window, just does what he does, and it just comes to him. You know, he's got two tricks, and then after that, just whatever, you know?
He just barely pulled off everything, but really he was in total control of the whole thing at all times.
I think when Dwayne came around, skateboarding was kind of like saved.
You would have the audience like jamming, like screaming at the top of their lungs, because here's the dude who almost killed himself, and now he's pulled it off, and now he's gonna maybe kill himself on the next wall. I think that gives you a crazy amount of energy as well.
For example, while most pros practice and hone their formulaic runs, Dwayne would pull up to the contest in a VW with a swastika painted on the hood, ignore his pounding hangover, skip his practice runs, and blow on by the roll-in channel to an acid drop into the deepest part of the pool. From there, he'd just go where his guts and lines led him. Dwayne's skating carried a great element of surprise and spontaneity, and the crowds ate it up.
The rad thing is, during the contest, they didn't really have music that we wanted to listen to. And because this new thing was coming from the streets, we wanted to listen to our own music. So we were the first guys to actually go, look, you know, here's our cassette. I'm going to listen to the Germs right here from my run. And Dwayne's all, you know, here's my cassette. I'm going to listen to Black Flag.
I remember going to the events and I was just so overwhelmed. Never seen so many skaters in one place.
There wasn't any comparison. We'd show up late, probably half in the bag, wouldn't take a practice run, nothing. Just do acid drop into the deep end and go, man. Guys non-fucking stop.
Hurt on my shoulder. Going. For acting out of line. You see the way I am. You leave it.
everyone was focused on competition then. So it was, there was strategies, you know, and people were like, I'm gonna see my best stuff for last. It seemed like Dwayne just went all out every time.
I think those guys, Dwayne especially, like, was performing rather than competing. It was how you did things and how you looked and how you acted that was more important than what you did almost. I think that's skateboarding.
And Dwayne never held back, but Dwayne didn't fall. So he was always in the finals.
He was just so sketchy, he would just go for shit. But then he would make it.
I'd say that after the Gold Cup, there hasn't really been a contest format or series as intense, as competitive as those days.
At that time, there was a huge Santa Cruz Veriflex rivalry. They were the stylish, aggressive guys, and the Veriflex guys were the more mechanical, very trick-oriented guys.
Here's a Santa Cruz dude that really don't care about the rest of this whole community of skateboarding. And then the rest of the community of skateboarding really didn't care about the Santa Cruz dude because the Santa Cruz dudes would spit on these dudes.
It was almost like a soap opera at the contest.
Such the rad thing at that point, you know what I mean? It was just like us against them. It was like, you know, the punk rockers against the straighties.
And there would be like almost fights here, it'd be tagonizing here, it'd be spitting on people here. They definitely liked to push people's buttons back then.
And then you had your speed and style guys versus the trick guys, Dwayne versus the Veriflex team, Dogtown versus Down South, and then you got the Badland guys with their whole turf, polished images, the Bones Brigade, and then you got Hassoy versus Hawk, Daggers versus the Ramp Locals.
North versus South, Good versus Evil, McDonald's versus Jack in the Box.
Doesn't really matter, but back then it was like definitely divided.
And you know, even now, once again, the Masters, you got Dwayne versus Eddie, so it seems like it's never really gone away. There's gonna be rivalries in skateboarding of different attitudes and opinions of speed and style versus crazy tricks and perfection, you know.
Dwayne played on that, and yet he didn't analyze it.
It was real as shit. You wouldn't go home and think about these guys. It's just when they're in your face.
He had a really bitchin' bent arm style that only an Orange County old school surf skater would know. He's got his arms up, you know, he's just like, it's like he's fighting or something.
Put your elbow in the air and just go as fast as you can. But if he gets in your way, bang, bang. And that's Dwayne's style.
Grasso first pointed that out to me, how to actually feel like a real skateboarder. You have to do that.
You have to point your finger on an ass drop. You have to. If you don't, you might as well not even do a fucking ass drop.
So we would roll in and point, and it was actually, it worked.
He would like actually hold on where most everyone else would like jump. He would still try to make it.
He had that crazy attitude and just the whole like, hey, I don't even care if I'm gonna get hurt.
His style is unique, man. It's just fucking the master's disaster.
And I was skating with Salba. Well, I wasn't skating with them. Salba and Dwayne were skating the half pipe, and I just kind of creeped over there like, oh, those guys are here, you know? And Dwayne sees me coming, and you can tell I'm, you know, starstruck, and he just spits right at me. He's like, this is punk rock, kid. And I was like, oh, just completely crushed.
I think Dwayne helped the fucking marriage of punk rock and skateboarding.
Being a skateboarder doesn't just mean being the best one, you know? I mean, people like Dwayne and Jay Adams and Tony Alva and Steve Olsen. I mean, these guys, they were incredible skaters, but it was their personality and their style and their attitude that made them as important to skateboarding as anything else.
Dwayne would take fucking kids in the bathroom and cut their hair off.
Blow out razor parties in the bathroom and give them a new name, butch their hair.
He cut our hair, and that was the thing, because everybody's getting their hair cut at Big O, right?
It all starts with that first haircut. That first haircut was a sign that you were the enemy against society, and we need to kill you.
You had to get a haircut, because it was no hippies, it was kill hippies.
I mean, Dwayne fucking took punk rock to where he thought it should go.
The whole industry was afraid of him, and a lot of skaters were too. I mean, you know, punk rock was still kind of new. You know, people just didn't understand what the fuck he was doing, and sometimes that was on purpose. He didn't want anyone to understand what he was doing, right? And he was just as belligerent as it got. But at the same time, it's like they cared more about their bands than they did about skating. You know what I mean? And I would see those guys at gigs more than I would at the skate park.
By then, Dwayne was as much a punk rocker as he was a skateboarder, neither of which went over well with his old man. In his eyes, Dwayne was a skateboarding bum who played shitty music with his loser buddies. That hurt Dwayne, but it also pushed him harder.
Fuck society and fuck you, dad, and fuck you, mom, and fuck you, boss, and
fuck the world and fuck you too, and you.
We pretty much were fueling the fire for punk rock music as well as for skateboarding. That was just how it was. You skated during the days and hung out and did your thing, and at night you went to the clubs and you went to go see bands, but and we were all in bands.
Johnny Rotten said, you know, anybody can put their own band together, so why couldn't we? You know, why couldn't the skaters?
It's like learning how to skateboard. We're learning how to play instruments.
Fuck, let's get a band together. Barkley, my best friend. What can you put? Bass, all right? Now, it's something easy for me, I'll sing.
When we started out, we played at his dad's garage, mall punk club, you know, wherever we could.
What's the first song? I don't want to be 30. 30's fucking dead. That's how you do it, look.
And these guys, being the skaters, I mean, even at the gigs, they were the most radical ones there too, and Dwayne got really into it. You know, bracelets with nails coming out of him, his fucking hair shaved on the sides, black on the top, blonde with swastikas and shit all over himself, and he was just so hardcore punk right away.
I'm just a weirdo, I guess. I don't know, I'd like it.
Just before skateboarding's second plunge in popularity, a new generation of rookie pros were clawing for the torch, but Dwayne wasn't about to hand it over.
Some of the, you know, park skaters of the day left. The people that came in for the next season, and Dwayne's still right there, is Caballero and Tony Hawk and Christian Hosoi and Grigowski. I mean, four names that are just all time right there.
You couldn't just show up and do the same tricks you did at the last contest. You better be learning the tricks that that other guy did that won, and you better be coming up with some new tricks.
It was a whole new guard, and it was a really strange time in skating. It was very transitional.
He thought their skating failed with respect to style and attitude. DP stuck to his guns and battled balls out against younger riders, many of whom would rise to legendary status during the late 80s halfpipe era. During the 1982 Turkey Shoot contest at Whittier, Dwayne's hold on the top of his game weakened, and the final blow would come from a young, unstoppable Tony Hawk skating in his first ever pro contest.
Well, my first pro contest was the Turkey Shoot Whittier. It was like 1982, and I remember I went pro by checking the pro box for the entry form. That's what it took to go pro in those days. and a lot of my peers were going pro, Billy Ruff, Neil Blender, Lester Kasai. You know, we'd all grown up skating together in the amateur series, so we just decided to go for it.
He had one Converse and one Vans. He looks over to me and he's just like, rip it up, rookie, you know, mocking me, like just kind of getting under my skin or whatever. Okay, two shoes.
Dwayne just hung a big loogie in Mike Smith's helmet and like, good luck. So he knew how to get inside the head.
In the finals, it was a head-to-head format, which means you pick two guys and they skate one against the other, and the winner advances, the loser goes to the loser bracket, and I came up against Dwayne at some point in the event.
Dwayne Peters, you just go head on head, two minutes left. Dwayne's up first.
She's a mother, 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 she I'm sure he didn't remember that I was the kid he spit on in Colton so many years ago, but I did.
Looking hot, beats out Wayne Peters at 86.66.
And I ended up beating him and going around the corner and yelling to myself, like, yeah, beat Dwayne, yes! And just come back trying to be all calm about it. And I think that was probably his last event from what I remember. That event was kind of the swan song for the old crew, you know, the Steve Olsen, Steve Alba, Mickey Alba, even Eddie didn't compete after that.
I didn't think they could take our place. I thought the new tricks that they were coming up with were so fucking corny that they wouldn't fly. That's why that contest hurt. Because it was like, come on, you're fucking kidding me, man.
Soon after Whittier, Dwayne moved to San Francisco, taking on odd jobs, playing in a few bands. He went to shows and hooked up with the Jacks, an underground skate clan whose lives revolved around skateboarding, playing music, going to all the gigs, and whichever drinks and drugs happened to come along.
His pro career kind of curved off and died down, and he was, you know, on to do other things.
I moved up north, and there was a whole nother world. There was the Jacks up there.
We were already kind of a crew. We all linked up and would, like, drink and go down to the punk pool at San Jose, and then Dwayne came along, and he was like us, only more so. And he happened to be a legend already at that time.
I became an honorary Jack, and they lived on their skateboards, and I just saw a whole nother way of living. Down here, they didn't really take their boards to the gigs. Up there, they were really proud of it.
Jack's period, you know, Dwayne stumbled through that one.
Dwayne was just unpredictable at that time. He was just always on some kind of a substance, his own trip, and didn't care about the outcome. It was just like, you know, seat of the pants, like, oh well.
At 23, Dwayne was well along the road towards hardcore drug addiction when he hit it off with a girl, Eva, from the same scene. They had their first child, a son named Skyler, and 2 years later, another boy, Chelsea. They survived on Eva's family kickdown along with their own desperate winnings from robbery and credit card scams. Dwayne's heroin addiction hit him in the bathroom away from the kids, who were told, Daddy's just sick right now, but he'll be okay.
That's a hardcore fucking thing to look in the mirror one day and just go, hey man, I gotta get off the shit, you know, and get back to that in real life.
Most of the junkies are one way or the other. Alcoholics won't fuck with junk, but I needed a drink. I like whiskey and I like heroin and I like coke with my heroin.
He was pretty fucking messed up.
Personally, I don't understand how he's still alive.
And if you got acid, I hate acid, but give me some of that.
I don't think that he actually intended on dying, but I just don't think he would have minded if it happened.
He'd always say the battery that would never die, and he never... It's incredible that he didn't. Your whole life consists of one way of living. Like, that's all you know. Like, you get one weird feeling, you go to the bottle.
Because it's just a blanket of, like, numbness, you know? And it's a good feeling, and it's a crutch, and it's everything. It's your best friend and your worst enemy.
Dwayne didn't think he would live past 30. Didn't think he would make it to 35, didn't make it to 40.
So I don't want to be 30. 30's fucking dead, man.
And if you got some speed and I can't sell it to a biker, I'll shoot that too.
And to do that for as long as Dwayne did, and then to fucking face up to, you know, Skyler and Chelsea and, like, his, you know, a life.
He was down and out, and, yeah, it was a nightmare, dude. I felt really bad on the one hand, but on the other hand, I was going, fuck, what are you even doing, you know?
You've turned into this person that you swore you'd never become, and you'd be sitting in jail and still don't know that you have a problem. All your friends will hate you. I still don't have a problem.
You know, there was times, though, back in the days that it was like, you know, what a fucking dick. There's a lot of dudes that never made it out of that shit.
Frequent bouts with rehab, countless overdoses, two DOAs, and a long criminal paper trail finally caught up with Dwayne and his girl. Eva went to prison, the kids went to her parents, and Dwayne slipped deeper.
We all just had the dread. You know, if you'd hear the phone ring at a certain time at night, you just thought it was something with Dwayne. He'd been going through so much. He'd been into so much rehab. And I mean, he got to the point where he didn't know that whether he could lick it. It was just like the devil on him. This one time, he just plain decided to end it all. And he took just about everything he could get his hands on. And I get the call, and he's down in Orange County, and he's in the hospital. And I had this doctor come up and look at me, and he says, "Are you his mother?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And he just kind of looked at me, and he says, "Well, I feel sorry for you." And I just broke my heart.
"So what the fuck, man? You don't like the way I look? Well, I don't like the way you look."
Failed attempts at sobriety sent him to the streets again. Addicted more to drugs than to skateboarding, Dwayne, at that time, was more a phantom in the skateboard world, rising from the underground to session a pool with his friends or show his face at a contest. Dwayne had missed the half-pipe heydays of the late 80s and had zero connection to the widespread skate culture of the mid-90s. The hip-hop, baggy pants, small board, and small wheels of modern street skating was the antithesis of Dwayne's days of big bowls, big boards, tall wheels, and punk rock. For the most part, his drive to ride slipped into a deep hibernation, and with his lady locked up, his kids off-limits, and his bridges burnt, music was the only thing he had left.
Dwayne Pettis, I don't know, he's like the only real, like, old school, like, dangerous punk left. Seen him at his best, seen him at his worst. You know, I've seen it all. I've seen it when, like I said, he's falling down drunk, you know, broken ribs. You know, I've actually helped him duct tape up his body so he could go on stage.
Do a backflip, land on his back, right on the fucking monitor, get up and just sing like nothing happened.
We're both all about trying to bring the danger element back to rock and roll. You leave bruised and bloody and begging for more. It's a war, and it's us against you. We live and die by rock and roll, period.
I always had to have a band, and we didn't care about recording. It was the last thing we ever thought about. We just had needed to have some songs together so we could play some gigs. Like The Sharks, Political Crap, File 17, and then I ended up in Fire Sports up in San Francisco. And then I was in a band called The Mess. Basically, the next band that actually recorded was Exploding Fuck Dolls, and that was with a couple skaters, the Godoy Brothers.
And Exploding Fuck Dolls started in about 1990. Me and Steve got together with a guy named Kevin Edmond. Kevin had a heroin problem. The reason we got Dwayne in the band was because we found Kevin dead in his room. And when Kevin died, we were really good friends with Dwayne. He was staying at some sober living house right up the street at the beach, and we're like, "What do you think, Dwayne, join up with the band?" We told him, "Look, we'll do a band with you, but you gotta be off of that shit. And the minute that you're back on that shit, you're out." We stirred up so much shit because the band was so militant with Dwayne in it. The things that fucked it up was the drugs.
One of my band rules was I don't ever want to be in a band longer than a year. Joined the Fuck Dolls, I was in it for my standard year, left, and then joined another band, the U.S. Bombs. The U.S. Bombs are troopers, and it's just a dysfunctional family on the fucking road. A lot of fighting and a lot of dysfunctional shit, but at the same time we saw the fucking world and we kicked some ass.
That's like that, that's what I say. Shot up in April, strung out in May. But I know it won't be too soon. When I'm back on 19 in June. They get the kick stomping on my dream. But I don't let it get me down. Cause this fucked up world keeps spinning around. Been a pop, been a pop, been a fire, been a pop, we had.
Comedy Central's Premium Blend, starring Jim Brewer and the music of U.S. Bomb. Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Brewer! One more time for the house band, U.S. Bombs.
Well, hello there, White House. We're KTP. Kill the
president!
Kill the president! Kill it, kill it, dead! Kill the president! With me! With me!
In the 90s, first with the exploding Fuck Dolls, then with the U.S. Bombs, Dwayne spent nearly 8 years on the road making music and getting by with a bottle and a needle and a sharpened drive towards self-destruction. He remembers much of his life at that time as a constant fight against road wear and band drama, at war with everybody, and they should all just fuck off and back off because he was just going to be dead soon anyway. He just figured a surprise overdose would just do him in, and that would be that. In the late 90s, the grandparents of his two sons called and asked if he wanted to visit his boys. Dwayne dropped everything and went to see Skylar and Chelsea. It was Dwayne's first contact with his boys in nearly a decade, and the reunion left Dwayne with a renewed idea that maybe life was the way to go. The year was 2000, and DP's best friend and U.S. Bombs guitarist Chuck Briggs died of AIDS. An overdose of depression slammed Dwayne, and what was left of him thought it best to clean up.
When it comes down to it, I think only the gnarliest and the most hardcore drinkers and users, they either end up dead, in jail, in an insane asylum, or sober. And sober is definitely the hardest, gnarliest thing to fucking do.
So there was just all this crazy shit, and then all of a sudden drugs just became too heavy. And then you're slamming dope on a toilet, just blood all over the ceilings, all over everywhere, and there's nothing to hit. And just going, what the fuck happened to me? This isn't me. I'm not supposed to be a drug addict. Even though I knew it was death, I was supposed to die, but I never died, and it was always going to come, and it just never happened. And you keep living, and then it just gets harder and harder. Then jail gets old. Walking the streets get old. And I'm getting old, and where the fuck is that skateboard? It was all about that saying, get busy living or get busy dying, and I started getting busy living again, and my skateboard was right there, and that's the bottom line.
Hurry, hurry, I can't be late, but I know that I'll be there at the right place.
life in music, too, took off renewed when he met ex-Nashville Pussy bass player and fire breather Corey Parks backstage at a Damn concert in Halloween of 2000. At the time, they were both sticking it out through their first few months of sobriety. Corey joined Dwayne's band, The Huns. They hit it off and hit the road, where Dwayne earned enough from his touring and record sales to pay off the tax man and years of overdue child support.
I like to have a mic in my hand and I like to have a skateboard under my feet. I had to put the Huns together because I needed to feel at home with my crew and I needed to feel like I was in a gang again and I needed to have fun and rock and roll again and feel like being in a band and on the road, you're kind of like Molasses of the Pirates because you're going into town and you're there to wreck everything in your way. It's just like a gang of pirates.
Years of this new millennium, Dwayne's commitment to sobriety coincided with the popular second coming of old-school skateboarding. Dwayne had never given up skateboarding, but in a sense, he was back. Skating vertical concrete again with the guys his age, along with a younger generation who'd learned to appreciate a style and attitude that identified skateboarding for several years and carried its image throughout the eras.
You watch him skate and it sparks that little fire in you, like the first time you went to your first punk show or something. It's just like, it's just, I don't know. There's a lot of attitude. It's sick. A couple bands that rip, and he skates and he rips, and it's just going off, man, you know? Like, it inspires me. Fucking one wheel bonking the coping on the way in. Like, oh my God, you're like looking the other way. You're so fucking scared. That's Dwayne Peters.
Men and women in their 40s dusted off their old skate decks or bought new ones from reissues of Wide Wood and Tall Wheels and hit up the free public skate parks that have been cropping up across the country for the past decade. Concrete, tiles, and coping were back.
There's something about the old days and the contest, and it's like the Soul Bowl's coming up, fucking cool. You know, it's kind of looser. You don't have to do a full minute or 2 minutes or whatever the fuck they were making us do.
We cramp the Soul Bowl, and we're like, this is where we need to bring the Masters back. You got guys like Steve Alba, Dwayne Peters, Eddie Elguera, all still skating better now than they ever have. And the Masters things are about fun. I don't think anybody goes there expecting winning money or fame. It's like, hey, what? The boys are sessioning? I'm on it. And him have kind of had this battle still, because Eddie is really polished and perfect. He's got all kinds of crazy, difficult tech tricks.
Elguera was just doing perfect, flawless runs.
But the judges always somehow seem to go with Dwayne because his style is so on edge.
Every single run he took, he was putting his life on the line. It made my hair stand up. Putting his life and body on the line, you know? And that's what Dwayne does. He puts his life and his body on the line every time he skates.
And that I really respect about Dwayne, because he's true, you know? There's not a lot of fucking guys that are in skateboarding that, you know, really say what they mean and stick by their words, you know? That's integrity, and Dwayne has that.
There's no way that he cannot skate. It's like so embedded in him.
When we were kids and we said we were gonna skate forever, you know, Dwayne is the model for that.
I think skateboarding really makes him happy. I think when he has a good day of skating, he's stoked. He's still stoked. He's still the Dwayne Peters with the shaggy blonde hair.
As long as we're standing, as long as our hands can fucking hold a mic or play an instrument, as long as I can still fit into tight pants and he can still take his shirt off, we're gonna be on stage till we are dead.
He's a survivor. Because he fucking works hard at what he does.
That guy's lived a hard life. I mean, he's always been fucking pushing it to the fucking maximum degree all the time.
Oh my God, you know, like, no teeth, fucking tattoos everywhere, and just grouchy and grumpy and scars. I mean, the guy is just fucking littered with scars.
I've heard him say it many, many, you know, as long as I can walk, I'll skate. And it's like, fuck yeah, right on.
Been on the verge of death for 25 years and still there.
It's hard to see your child go through the things that he's went through. And I think there's still some things that he's still working through.
As with any lifelong drug addict, Dwayne's demons still haunt him, and he doesn't pretend that this new, cleaned-up existence is not a day-to-day struggle. But in his voice, you can hear an appreciation for this new time. He's sincerely thankful for what he has and that his twisted story could very well end on a good note.
The way the world is, you know, isn't perfect, but, you know, I like it a lot better than I used to because, you know, it's all new to me. You got to enjoy the ride. You got to at some point go, you know what, you know, this is kind of funny, you know? And if you look at it like that, it doesn't hurt so bad. You know, most of the shit that used to hurt wasn't real anyway. Without those times, you don't got the roller coaster ride. You know, there you go.
It's so simple. Dwayne Peters is a one-of-a-kind, die-hard, passionate motherfucker.
Clean slate and clear heads, Corey and Dwayne embarked on a new adventure together. And on November 24, 2004, Corey gave birth to their son, Clash Thomas Peters. With years of sobriety under their belts, they've a house down by the beach, they've got the band, and with the birth of their baby boy, they have a family.
Fucking break. I'm gonna fucking kill somebody. Give me my goddamn skull.
We gotta ride. We gotta skate. We gotta ride. We gotta skate.
Sure, Dwayne has lived the spectrum. A legend, a nobody, champion, loser, an inspiration, junkie, father, a deadbeat, and a dead man. But to him, it's all come full circle. He's just a punk rocker and a skateboarder. Period.
One, two, three, four.